So my name is David Gissen. I'm a professor in the architecture division here at CCA, and I work co-direct with Irene the experimental history project and the MAD degree in history theory experiments. So before introducing Jeffrey Schnapp, I just want to thank Irene Cheng again for conceiving and organizing this really fantastic conference. I really enjoyed the presentations and the discussions we had earlier. And also, of course, thank all the conference attendees for coming here. And then finally, also thank you to Jonathan Massey for encouraging events like this and encouraging Irene and I to really push the envelope of what experimental history could or might be. So I'm going to introduce Jeffrey Schnapp, who's giving our keynote tonight. So Jeffrey Schnapp is professor of Romance Languages and Literature and Comparative Literature at Harvard University. And he's also on the teaching faculty in the Department of Architecture at Harvard University's Graduate School of Design. He founded Harvard's MetaLab, which is a vanguard research center for conceptualizing the digital humanities. Much of Jeffrey's scholarship examines the formation of European modernism, and he is an author of many influential books, articles, and exhibitions. And before arriving at Harvard, he was based here in the Bay Area as a professor at Stanford and was for several years the director of the Stanford Humanities Center. And among the many projects staged by Jeffrey at Stanford, his year-long investigation of crowds, is a key facet of modernity, is a model of interdisciplinary examination and experimentation. I strongly encourage all of you to look at that book. In the past 10 years, Jeffrey's emerged as a leader in the field of the digital humanities. As the director of the MetaLab, Jeffrey oversaw the development of several key projects, including Cold Storage, a documentary about Harvard's book depository, Curarium, a platform for developing dynamic data portraits and associations between museological artifacts, and several publication projects, including The Library Beyond the Book, which is co-authored with Matthew Battles, and that confronts the purported demise of the library in the face of digitalization. The book explores, quote, what libraries have been in the past to speculate on what they will become, hybrid spaces that intermingle books and ebooks, analog and digital formats, paper and pixels. And that obviously serves as an analog to many of the discussions we've already had here today. So we're very excited to have Jeffrey here today as an important scholar within the arts and humanities, and as someone who will enable us to consider existing and emerging platforms as sites for the production of knowledge. So please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you so much to all of you for being here, and in particular to Irene and David and Jonathan for the invitation. Thank you for bringing out rainy and bad weather in the Bay Area so that I don't feel too nostalgic coming from Boston back to the city that I lived in for 26 years while I was at Stanford. When I first received this invitation, what excited me in particular was not just the main title, Platforms, Augmented Histories of Space, even though I could really wrap my head around that for a good hour, but in particular these two questions that were posed to us as part of the overall framework for the discussion today, which are these questions. How might historians employ mobile, locative, and pervasive technologies to present research in more immersive and engaging formats? And second of all, what can scholars learn from transmedia artists and technologists in exploring the boundaries of experimental film, documentary, and mobile media? And they're really such central questions to really a lot of what I've been doing and thinking about for the last 15, 20 years that the real challenge I faced in trying to contribute to this conversation and really was trying to decide where to engage and enter into each of these questions. For pretty much the time since I've been at Harvard, I've been teaching or co-teaching a course called Mixed Reality City, which is a practice-based studio that involves essentially curating urban landscapes as if they were art galleries would be one way to describe it. Jonathan was kind enough or cruel enough to mention Ziga, which was a software platform that was built literally to serve the interests, the pedagogical practice of mixed reality city as a course. The idea being to kind of literalize the notion of the World Wide Web as a kind of library in motion that could be multimedia library in motion that could be tapped to assemble on the fly, grab contents, assemble them quickly, and to deploy them in ways that involved often locative technologies. So in some of the early projects we did in Mixed Reality City, we had students going out and annotating buildings in the physical landscape so that when one passed through those locations, the buildings would talk to you or send you text messages or the like. So for me, this issue really is one that comes right to the really captures everything from pedagogy to research to a whole series of experimental publishing ventures that I've been involved in. So what I've chosen to do in this process is not to try to capture all of that, but to give you a little bit of a sampler, maybe in the spirit of the panel discussion, which we were just privileged enough to listen to, of some of the areas of practice that I've been involved in. I'm kind of going to go from the digital end of the spectrum, sort of all digital all the time, to all analog all the time. And what I'd like to do is to translate these questions into a couple of other questions, some of which have been touched upon already, but that I'd like to, in a sense, further specify and underscore, since I have the privilege of having a little bit of additional time up here. And some of the questions that I would translate these questions into that will come back in the course of this presentation are, how do we make scholarly or historical knowledge matter to contemporary audiences that are unlikely ever to pick up a scholarly monograph or a specialized journal? Yeah. It isn't just democratizing knowledge, creating models of participation. It's also, in a sense, finding new kinds of languages that create new points of access and new kinds of experiences, designing those experiences. A second question that really interests me, and the Crowds Project was really, in a sense, the catalyst, was certainly the first really in-depth experiment in this along these lines, is how are we to reinvigorate traditional formats, the formats that are alluded to in the first of the questions. How do we reinvigorate them and imagine new roles and destinies, for example, for print culture in an era of ubiquitous networks and ubiquitous digital media? I think one of the big questions that digital humanists ought to be engaged in is precisely the reimagining of print as a medium. Within these two questions is really the question that interests me the most right now, certainly in most of the areas of practice I'm involved in, which is really, I think, a design challenge that undergirds pretty much all of the areas of design practice that I'm involved in, directly or indirectly. And it came up very explicitly in the panel discussion, and that is this question of how we weave together information and space in meaningful ways, not in trivial ways. There's lots of trivial ways to do it. We're all familiar with what those are. When you walk around a museum and you see everybody staring at their phone so that they can take a picture, that clearly would be a kind of act of interpretation, if you like, or a kind of intrusion of a kind of form of mediation that most curators would see as a failure. So how do we design these kinds of genres of communication, of cultural experience, for example, so that the device becomes part of the process rather than a kind of interrupter of a process? This issue of weaving together information and space is not just a question of how to stage experiences or choreograph them in certain ways. It's also fundamental to thinking about what a learning space is in the 21st century. David mentioned this larger project on libraries that I've been involved in, and I'll touch upon that in passing, but I think we all know what we're very early in the digital revolution at this stage. We're very early in this kind of set of cultural and social shifts that have happened around the ubiquity of networks, screens, smart devices, and so forth, to really find non-trivial ways to weave them together to imagine a world where we constantly move back and forth across media in the process of producing knowledge and sharing knowledge is still in its infancy. And I think a lot of the excitement for me in being at that sort of frontier line is getting to participate in the fun of trying to invent solutions that hopefully produce non-trivial results. The last point I want to make by way of framing this series of reflections is, and this came up also in the panel discussion, is this question about tools and platforms. And I think, as Irene implied pretty clearly, it's essential to keep in mind that one of the reasons why it's important that designers, artists, humanists, people who carry with them the kinds of traditions of critical inquiry, scrutiny, attention to complexity, and so forth, that they're at the table when tools and platforms are built, is that tools are not just tools and platforms are not just platforms. They are cognitive filters. They create certain kinds of possibilities and close down others. And I think one of the challenges for us as a community of creative practitioners around the whole world of digital media, digital tools, digital analytics, et cetera, is precisely to be engaged in the very design of those tools so as to ensure that the kinds of ways in which they enable us to engage with the world are those ways that we care about, that we think are important. So the general world framework within which I work is what has came to be called digital humanity sometime around the year 2000. This label sort of stuck, and it's really a label. I've, like all labels, it does a certain violence to what was the spirit of the initiative, but it also helps because it explains what otherwise are such a heterogeneous set of otherwise disconnected forms of inquiry and experimentation. So I both embrace and also struggle with this label. I struggle with the word digital because I think often the word suggests some kind of primacy, almost a kind of a sort of protagonist role for tools and techniques, when in fact a lot of the questions that strike me as the really interesting and meaty questions don't have to do with the digital per se. They have to do with something else, which is much more complex, which is the weaving together again of the analog and the digital. They have to do with culture, with genres. They have to do with experience. The word humanities makes me nervous for a different reason, which is it sort of resolves the issue of what the terrain is on which one is experimenting before you've even begun experimenting. And a lot of the work I do, I'm not sure whether it's in the humanities or whether it's a form of creative practice or it's something else. I'm more interested in embracing what I see as a core set of values associated sometimes with the digital humanities, although digital humanities comes in a lot of flavors. But if that phrase stands for anything, I think it stands for a couple of things that I do think are rich and important and continue to be promising in terms of this early sort of process of development of new models of communication, new knowledge forms, new genres of scholarly practice, new forms of cultural and artistic practice. Some of those values have to do with teamwork and collaboration, with the complexity of the tasks that are being undertaken requiring different kinds of competencies. It's the kind of big mosaic approach to fundamental questions of culture and society, built on specialized micro forms of expertise, but building bigger pictures. among those values, I would include also an increasing experimentation with an idea, with a notion of knowledge that emphasizes process rather than product, that thinks about what it means to be in a world, a community that's dedicated to something that is ultimately not reducible to the sort of building blocks that have defined much of the knowledge ecology over the course of the last two centuries associated with certain forms of publishing. I think included in those would certainly be an attention to expanding the kind of sensorium of cultural memory and history and so forth. This kind of emphasis on sound, which I think was quite palpable in the roundtable discussion, is the allusion to histories of smell, senses that have not been prioritized, if you like, in the cultural record for all kinds of absolutely straightforward reasons having to do with the ability to access elements from the past centuries later. They suddenly, I think, have become a particular focus of this sort of experimental scholarship. And I'm a medievalist by training, and so the way I started thinking about this question a long time ago was realizing that we know that much of the most vital portions of medieval culture were performance-based. And of course, performance leaves very limited traces, particularly in a manuscript culture, where manuscripts themselves are expensive artifacts reserved to a relatively small circle of society. But starting in 1900, the soundtrack of human culture begins to become increasingly available. And now, as we approach the present, we have this kind of pervasive network of ways of capturing aspects of the sound environment that we live in, not to mention other aspects. And I think it's not surprising that these kinds of new opportunities have become the focus of particularly a really exciting experimentation in the present moment. At the core of all of these values, I think, is an embrace of experimentalism. And a kind of a rejection of a certain kinds of culture of risk aversiveness within the academic world, a commitment to open knowledge sharing, and a real focus, and I think this is where the humanities piece does matter, a kind of criticality vis-a-vis the question of really exploring where digital media add value and where they don't. Understanding and grasping how we can make certain kinds of experiences, defining experiences, new experiences that truly augment in the qualitative sense our experience, for example, of an urban landscape. That's an interesting challenge. And going back to my time at the Stanford Humanities Lab, which we started in 1999, there were three of us who thought this was a good idea. A lot of people didn't. But what at the core of what we were trying to think about back at the Humanities Lab was this question of what are the kinds of cultural experiences that we can enable through the recourse to digital media, to digitally grounded approaches. And I've come to really to prefer the label knowledge design to the label digital humanities, because I like both of these words a little bit more than I like the other two words. One, because one of the big, I think, defining questions of our time, particularly if you're in a domain that involves the production and the reproduction of some kind of set of expert discourses, knowledge forms, and so forth, is what kind of shapes it takes. What are the forms that it assumes? The answer, the traditional answer, of course, or at least traditional for the last century or two, has assumed certain forms of publication. But we've entered a world where those forms have proliferated, have exploded in a sense. There's so many different channels, so many ways of producing knowledge and sharing knowledge, and indeed so many ways of producing even in the sense of the kinds of supports that are implied, the sorts of structures of collaboration, the sorts of models of dissemination. All of this stuff is up for grabs, and that's exciting if you're a scholar, I think. So at MetaLab, we struggle with this issue a lot. We redefine ourselves pretty much on a yearly basis. So the current definition we've been playing around with, which I'm relatively happy with, is the idea that we're not a digital humanities center, we're a concept foundry, a place that explores ways of forging concepts, that genres that make sense or might not make sense. Maybe they don't, they fail. But most of all, we're a knowledge design lab that tries to explore those kinds of productive conjunctions of the analog and the digital, and that serves, above all, as a kind of translational space between thinking and making, between pure and applied domains. And these are some of the fields in which our projects have unfolded. I'm not going to talk about all of them. I'm going to use the Digital Underscore Humanities book as a kind of entry point here to just talk really about five. I confessed my ambivalence towards the label Digital Humanities. So how do you explain the fact that I'm the co-author of a book entitled Digital Humanities? Well, it's the underscore that's the key piece here. That underscore is where the knowledge design happens. It's how the digital moves towards the humanistic and back. So I'm always upset when I see the underscore disappearing in library catalogs. So what does this book try to do, and what do I think of as the task of this experimental domain? It's answering really this question. So the recognizable form we all know is a form associated with the codex, with its descendant in advanced industrial print culture. And print is a fantastically powerful medium. It resolves many kinds of questions and creates other kinds of opportunities and as well as limitations. And we're experiencing right now, of course, we have been experiencing now for some time, really. This process began back early in the 20th century, but it's exploded under digital conditions. A kind of explosion of the book itself, accompanied by a proliferation of other kinds of media opportunities, channels, and modes, and so forth. So the question that I think is the interesting question is really, what is that form? What are those forms that knowledge could take or should take? What are the forms that we dream of, that we want, that seem to us powerful, that could take the place of some of the consolidated and sedimented genres of the past? So in this little march, I'm going to just give you five models. And I think of this work really as modeling work more than anything. It's experimental, but it it involves making as a form of thinking. And the five examples I'm going to look at are, I want to start first with the question of archives, of what's different about archives today, potentially, from the kinds of archives that we traditionally associate with institutions of memory, of preservation, of documentation. The example I'm going to show is from the Digital Archive of Japan's 2011 disasters. The second has to do with what it means to live in a world, which is a very recent world, I might add, where networks have invaded natural landscapes. I'm sure most of you in this room can still remember the moment when you used to have to go around hunting for a hotspot to find a signal in order to get connected to the web. It is now the case that you can walk through, be on a hike in a national park, and still be completely wired in to a worldwide web of connections, not just telephonic, but ones including intercomputer communications. So what are the consequences for this kind of weaving together of information and space to have a natural world, which has now been connected to urban landscapes, to live in a truly connected world? And the example there I'm going to look at briefly is a kind of incomplete project, but a beginnings of a project that started up a couple years ago called, that has multiple names because it's failed to sort of mutate into a full-scale project. But the original title was Digital Ecologies of the Arnold Arboretum. The third has to do with what happens to print in the digital age. And sometimes people refer to these sort of modes of experimentation, and the Crowds book was one instance of such, as print plus publishing. In other words, rather than viewing digital publishing channels as antagonists to print, to try to think about what print can do in the digital age that's distinctive or adds value and that interacts with or dovetails with other modes of publication. Because, of course, publication modes have never been an either-or proposition. And there, the example that I will touch upon briefly is cold storage. Cold storage is a database documentary, but it's also the last chapter of a book. And the book itself has other extensions to it. including a card deck, which I have a copy of right here. The fourth is the question of data, as the sort of marble and clay of the 21st century, the stuff that we need to learn to sculpt into things of beauty, things that stories that are compelling, narratives that, however, that don't necessarily obey the usual scale that we associate with human experience. Data typically take us, zoom us out into the macro or zoom us down into micro worlds that don't correspond to the usual stratum of storytelling. So what do we do with that whole world of storytelling that is no longer storytelling in any conventional sense? I think that's a really exciting domain. We've done some experiments with this, in particular in art museums, trying to imagine what meaningful experiences of are of collections as aggregates, but also that allow you to zoom back down through those collections into the microscopic particulars of a single object. How can we make that a cultural experience that adds value to the more conventional human scale experience that has been part of the world of culture for many, many centuries? And last but not least, in sort of going back to the pure analog, I want to look at just one example. It's, I think, largely a failed example, so it's a kind of modest closing gesture of a curatorial project that I did, an experimental project called the Trento Tunnels, or the Galleries of Memory, which is an attempt to create an experimental history museum without objects, a kind of history museum that would bring history alive, that make arguments about history without relying upon the power of original objects, and to find interesting ways to weave digital media-based experiences into that process. So let me start here with an instance that brings together two of the themes of emerging new genres, answers to this question about what forms knowledge takes in the 21st century, which are these questions of scale, of macro and micro, this sort of zoomability of the digital, of digital forms of memory, documentation, that represent a new kind of horizon for, from the standpoint at least of traditional forms of documentation of history and its events. That on the one side. And on the other side, this question of the archive, of these repositories, the places where, in a sense, memories are constructed and stored. And I'm just gonna play this little clip while I talk for a second. This project was born roughly in the months immediately after the 2011 March, the 3/11 earthquakes in Japan. The Reischauer Institute of Japanese Studies at Harvard, which is one of the many institutes devoted to research on Japan, immediately realized that the earthquake and the tsunami and its aftermath, the nuclear accident, were events that were going to transform the history of that region of Japan, but probably of the entire Asian region. And therefore, that these were events that were worthy of being archived. They needed to somehow be captured and documented. But what does it mean to document or archive an event? First of all, an event that is not finished and will not be finished probably for decades and decades, maybe even longer. What does it mean in an era like our own? Initially, several institutions, the Reischauer included, were thinking, of course, that they were going to capture documentation in the most traditional forms. They were going to look to government ministries, to newspapers, and so forth. But of course, most of the documentation of this event was on devices like this, in the pockets of people who had literally experienced, who were the victims of the event, or who were involved in any number of different kinds of operations in and around the impact zone, in the aftermath, moving people out of the damaged area, and so forth. So this project, which Metalab served as a kind of incubator for, working together with a whole series of partners, was an attempt to construct a new kind of archive. We like to call it an animated archive, but another way to describe it is that it's a distributed multimedia archive. And that might not seem like such a big deal. But to actually create a kind of consortium of parties who are all willing to invest very substantial resources, human resources and the first instance, to collaboratively build an asset that only exists virtually. In other words, that all of these materials that are gathered together are only integrated into a single structure through a web-based portal. It's like a kind of fiction of unity that's created through the web platform, where the actuality, the reality of storage, of accumulation, of curation, of management, of preservation is happening in a kind of archipelago of institutions, all of whom have committed to preserve this or that. And in fact, if you look at the parties that make up the Japan Disasters Archive, there's about 40 different entities. Flickr Japan is collecting the photographs. InternetArchive.org is collecting the tweets, in part because Japanese privacy law doesn't allow any Japanese institution to collect the tweets. There's 8 million tweets that are part of the archive and growing. There are hundreds and hundreds of thousands of text documents, web crawling software that are being basically states of websites being captured, saved to the University of Virginia, and so on and so forth. So I'm just going to just quickly go out to show you what I think is really exciting about this kind of venture. No, I'm not a new user. Thank you. But what I want to show you is just a couple of attributes, which I think are the ones that raise this bigger knowledge design question. Namely, what is it that I can now do that I couldn't do before under a more traditional model of archiving? Yes, this is a participatory archive. The web portal brings together all under a kind of illusory single umbrella all these resources that are actually vastly distributed. Yes, the artifacts are incredibly variable. They include everything. I mean, this is just I could click through different. No, I don't want to translate. collections of video, text, images, testimonials, tweets, text messages. You pretty much name it. But what I think is really rich and promising and striking is that I can look at these from so many different angles. I can look at them from the standpoint of topography. So here, if we want to look at, for example, the distribution of testimonials, we can see where they came from, or we can look at the distribution of tweets. And yes, we can also create timescales that allow us to see, let's look at all formats here. We can see actually the evolution of how these forms of documentation were produced in the course of time. And I can get the granularity of this narrative, which is of course a polyfaceted narrative, down to the level of tenths of seconds. Now, as a cultural historian, I'm usually really excited if I can get an event or a series of important transformations down to a scale of weeks or months. But the idea that we can start to think about events, reconstruct events, document events on a scale of tens or hundreds of seconds, and then zoom out, which we can do as well, to the scale of decades and maybe centuries, I think begins to suggest how we've moved outside of the usual cognitive scale on which forms of memory are constructed. But we've also changed the audience for whom an archive is built, because this is an archive that is usable for so many different kinds of things, for reconstructing the story of how my grandmother spent the last 15 minutes of her life. In other words, a victim narrative, or for analyzing very large macro kinds of phenomena. It's that ability to reimagine an institution, a venerable institution like an archive, that excites me around these kinds of projects. And so I see this at least as one example of the kinds of opportunities we have to shift. So I'm going to go now to a second domain, which is not unrelated. It also has to do with the role that archives can play as elements in augmenting experience. In this case, I'm going to focus on two other sort of sub-themes within that chapter of digital underscore humanities, the role of visualization and data design on the one side, and the other, locative investigation, one of the themes that was touched upon, I think, very richly in the round table discussion. Now, collections, of course, come in many shapes and sizes. We have cities themselves, which are collections of architectural constructs. We have book document collections, like libraries, but we also have living collections. At Harvard has among its many sort of appendages what most people perceive as a public park called the Arnold Arboretum, but in fact it's a research facility with a botany lab right on the grounds. And it was built, like many botanical gardens throughout the world, as a space of investigation, where scientists were seeking to somehow represent the diversity of tree forms, in this case, and to do so by constructing a kind of ideal scheme that is just as artificial as the structure of the galleries of the Metropolitan Museum of Art are. So the Arnold Arboretum, which is this park that has 15,000 trees that have been collected, they started to be collected in the mid 19th century, all the way through the present, experienced as a park, a place of recreation, a natural site by most of the public that makes use of it to jog, to visit, etc., is a kind of living museum. It's a living collection. And the remarkable thing about a facility that was designed, and this is, again, true of many botanical gardens and many, you know, similar kinds of structures, is that every gesture that was ever accomplished in this landscape, every plant that was ever planted in the soil, had a passport, it has an archival record, we know everything about how it arrived, when it arrived, under what conditions, and even if it died, it's still in the archive. So the question we were fascinated by here was this question of, like, how could we activate all this really cool, amazing stuff to make it part of your experience? Like, to make it possible for people who otherwise might view a park like this as a natural landscape, instead to see it as a constructed landscape filled with knowledge forms. And I'm just touching upon the tip of the iceberg, because, of course, there's some fantastic open science resources. There's some amazing resources that the Mellon Foundation and several other foundations, like Sloan, have contributed to, having to do with seed libraries, with just all kinds of aspects of documentation of the natural world. So how could we bring that kind of richness of materials somehow into the experience of the physical space of this landscape that was constructed as an open-air classroom but isn't used as an open-air classroom? That was really the core set of challenges that we were looking at. And this really comes back to the question that was touched upon a little bit earlier, which is, like, how do we make these smart devices that are sometimes not so smart augment our experience rather than distract from our experience of a landscape like this? So the idea, and as I said, this is a project that it was, you know, never really completed, but these are the sketches for it, was to transform the phone into the equivalent of Charles Darwin's field notebooks. The typical botanist of the 19th century spent a lot of time honing their skills, drawing, observing, writing in their notebooks. This is how botany as a science advanced in the course of that was the methodology that the science was built upon. So what if your phone was to become essentially the kind of analog, the descendant of the field notebook? So what you're doing with the phone is not being guided through not having information loaded down to you, or, you know, essentially being scripted in your interaction with the landscape through the phone, but rather the phone is the discovery device, but with which you go out and you study and capture aspects of this landscape. So what you see here are a series of scripted ways in which the phone could be used, for example, for a visitor to the Arboretum or a class, to go and engage, either participate in citizen science projects that involve honing your observational skills. In other words, going back to this idea that the phone, like the notebook, is a tool for perfecting observational skills and for contributing knowledge to a larger community of knowledge sharing that's focused on events that are meaningful events in this particular environment for gaining an understanding of the arboretum. I'm not going to walk you through all the details here, but I think you can see that one of the ambitions here was to create something that's much more of a kind of process-based approach to delivering an experience that involves the construction of a kind of community of maybe amateur botanists, but who view their engagement with the landscape more as a kind of curatorial engagement than simply that a kind of recreational engagement. So we carried out a bunch of experiments with this, and I'm just going to show you some examples of this. Was from a workshop that my colleague Yanni Lukisos ran with a bunch of high school students, believe it or not, trying to take the data sets. So I was focusing there initially on not on the data sets or the archives, but rather on the landscape and how we could make the landscape into a place of kind of observational study and experience. But then to take the data sets and to try to transform those into forms that would somehow speak the language, a language that is, in a sense, cast in the same mold as the Arboretum itself. These were just some initial sketches, taking the entire archive of the Arboretum and turning it into a series of visualization modes, installing it in a physical space for one of our open lab days. So this is a projection-based system where you see all 140 years of the Arboretum reduced to a series of visualizations. And of course, as human beings, we're not really good at seeing 140 years at once, not to mention fit the lives of 15,000 plants. And one of the things that good data visualizations do, and here's another experiment, which I'll show you the eventual sort of destiny of. Is this running? Okay, yeah, it's running. I don't know if you can see it. So this is, again, another, it's basically taking the same data. This visualization was done by Christelle Denis. And using the structure of the tree as the framework for showing the development of the collecting practices of the Arnold Arboretum in the course of its history, from the beginnings all the way out to the present. And it's a little easier to show in a publication that is an experimental publication that that Yanni Lukisos, who is the project head on this on this venture, this portion of the Arboretum project, came up with. And that challenge was how to put together a kind of analytic, argumentative, textual structure with the archive itself, how to integrate them into a single sort of mixed hybrid artifact. So here you have the entire archive of plant accessions from 1872 to 2012. That's what you're seeing here on the left side. And on the right side, you have an argument which describes the methodology that was used in this project, some of the history of the Arboretum itself, a series of diagrams, illustrations, and so forth that show classifying taxonomical practices that were employed by the Arboretum. And at any point in this timeline, you can actually decide to dive into the archive itself and see what each of these records are. So the metadata fields, portions of them at least, are exposed as you move through this span on the left. And almost at any point in the argument that's unfolded on the right, there's an element that crisscrosses into this visualization of the archive on the left. All this to just suggest that even though we never achieved this interest that we had in developing a kind of full experience of the landscape, this kind of augmented experience of the landscape, we do think that somewhere in the place where well-sculpted, crafted representations of data and that landscape, there's something there that really adds value and that changes the nature of the experience that represents a really powerful, at least potential, that is worthy of being explored. Okay, I'm going to stop this and see if it'll go to. So I want to now turn to cold storage as a this time an example of two other themes, but themes that I think have already been anticipated. One of them is this issue of what happens to print under the kinds of expanded possibilities and conditions that we encounter today. And second of all, this genre that I alluded to a little bit before, but I think maybe bears a little bit of explanation, which is what happens to documentaries, to these forms that were one of the traditional, conventional, certainly in the 20th century, one of the defining ways in which we told history, or we translated the world of documents or archives into a story, a narrative. With the rise of databases, of course, the possibility of taking everything that would have ended up in a conventional documentary on the cutting floor and to weave it into the documentary itself becomes possible. But how to do so in a way that doesn't just create more mess, more confusion, less story, less impact, less meaning? Those are the kinds of questions that I think are interesting. So in the case of cold storage was the result of a design studio that we started in 2012 called Library Test Kitchen. The idea was to create a kind of studio dedicated to thinking propositionally about the future of libraries, about libraries on all kinds of scales. The second was create some kind of multimedia extension of the book that Matthew Battles, my collaborator, and I were writing at the time, The Library Beyond the Book, which was itself largely informed by the design studio that we had been running. I mentioned the studio. The fourth was to think about the question of how to take, in this case, the institution that is at the heart of the Harvard Library System. We could have taken any number of other similar institutions, but the place where the stuff that makes up one of the world's largest libraries is actually stored, but it's a location that's off-site, that's off-campus, that's actually inaccessible to the vast, by far the vast majority of the people who use the library system at Harvard. And we thought it was an interesting task. We had all this kind of documentary material, but how to translate all of that documentary material into an experience, in a sense, that would be somehow meaningful with and resonate with a larger conversation, ongoing conversation within society at large, and at Harvard in particular, about the future of libraries, the degree to which we need to envisage libraries in new and distinct ways in the context of the proliferation of digital channels of publication. And last but not least, one of the ideas that we had that came out of the design studio was to take classic library films and to use them as the sort of matrix out of which to weave this experiment, which we called cold storage. So I'm not going to dwell on this. So I mentioned it was a component of the studio. The book itself was meant as a kind of book that would be playful and have a lot of curb appeal by scholarly book standards. One of its features is that it has these provocations that run along the margin. They run vertically. So you have to turn the book to read it. It's a little graphic trick stolen from the McLuhan Quentin Fiore playbook. And those provocations in turn exist as a card deck, which can be used by designers and architects, people involved in the actual problem and process of designing libraries for today and tomorrow, as a way of provoking, of getting themselves out of their comfort zone. And in the course of the design studio, we students, other participants, librarians who participated as well, we generated a tremendous amount of documentation of this structure, which is the Harvard Depository, located 45 minutes outside of Boston, on a hill protected behind a sort of security wall, in part because the primate labs are located out there and they're terrified that the PETA activists will show up and liberate the chimpanzees. But so how to put all of these materials together really is the question we're interested in. How to make a database, an archive, an institutional portrait of an institution like a book depository, a story that would somehow be compelling and that would resonate in dialogue with these larger debates about the present and future of libraries. And last but not least, again, the question of how to take some of the narratives that have been the defining narratives of the modern library, like Alain René's wonderful short documentary, All the World's Memory, a kind of loving but kind of mischievous portrait of the National Library of France, and to retell those stories for our own age. I'm just going to really quickly show you, or I was going to, but I just got moved beyond that. Let's see if this will let me. So I was just going to quickly show you. So where do all these pieces meet? And this is the kind of knowledge design challenge, is how do we get a book to talk productively to a card deck, to interact productively with a documentary film? And I think the answer, I hope the answer that's compelling here, and you can look at it yourselves with in your own time, is what you'll find here on this website, where we have the documentary film used as the navigation system for the archive. So as you watch the film, you're actually moving through the bays of the Harvard Depository. And each of these bays is made up of hundreds of media objects of different kinds, from field interviews with people who work in this space to archival documents. All of them are sort of organized, but using the narrative of the documentary as the sort of spine that holds them together in a single structure. So you can basically experience this both as a traditional documentary that goes on for 26 minutes, or you can experience it moving back and forth between these different strata that make it up. Okay. All right. And the book itself, as I mentioned, is an experimental book. It plays with micro narratives, macro arguments. I'm not going to dwell on those. I want to close here with by just saying a couple things about. Okay. I want to talk a little bit about the Lightbox Gallery and then close with the Trento tunnels. So. Two other themes that are part of this kind of universe of emerging genres, new possibilities, I think, have to do with, again, this issue of what we do with quantities, with aggregates that are aggregates that go beyond the kinds of ordinary sort of horizons of our experience as individuals. My colleagues and I, for a while, have been really excited about collections databases in this regard, in part because as collections databases become increasingly visible and accessible to the outside world, opportunities have opened up to do things with them as researchers through open APIs, for example, that allow us to leverage their power, their data sets that have been put together by experts, just like library catalogs have been put together by experts. But typically, they have been resources that are inward-facing, that are used by people who are on the inside, who are managing collections and so forth. As they become public-facing, the opportunity to use them for storytelling on all kinds of scales becomes available. The immediate task that we were lucky enough to be able to undertake had to do with the Harvard Art Museums when the Harvard Art Museums were closed. and in the building was in the process of being rebuilt, there was one gallery that was left over that wouldn't work for any conventional art object because it's a corridor, but not big enough to be a regular gallery. And moreover, it's right under the sunroof, this sort of greenhouse-like roof that Renzo Piano designed, which means that no work on paper could ever be exposed there, even for 15 minutes, because it's way, way too bright. So the question is, what do we do with this like leftover space? At the top, in this beautiful kind of, you know, towering location overlooking the courtyard of the building, and the Lightbox Gallery was what we came up with. And it has two elements. I don't know if you can see this very clearly. One is a projection system that projects on a series of shades that overlook the internal courtyard. And the other is a screen, a kind of wall of monitors that face it. And the two interact with one another. And the basic idea that was developed for this particular site was that all of the objects that are physically accessible and on exhibit on all the other floors of the building, in the Lightbox Gallery, they can be seen all at once, whatever that means. And so the question was, what does that mean? And how can we create an experience that doesn't try to compete with the objects that exist on other floors, but rather sort of celebrates the digitality, the surrogacy of these digital surrogates? How could we make the fact that they are forms of digital media essential to your experience of them? So now what I'm going to do, living a little dangerously, oh, there we go. Yeah, that's what I suspected. Okay, let's try. I'm going to go out and I'll do this from outside. Okay, let's see. It's going to show you. All right, we'll go to... No, forget it. Okay. It's always bad to run demos live, but it's irresistible sometimes. Okay. So this is what happens. When you walk into the gallery, what you get is an object map, which is what I was going to just pull up for you. An object map which has 1,800 art objects, all of which are on exhibition. You've already seen every single one of them. And if you click on any single one with an air mouse, you see this, which is basically most of the metadata associated with that object, which is concealed to everyone, including the people who use the inventory systems, typically. And if you move around and touch any of those metadata fields, you can open up different kinds of avenues that reshuffle the entire collection of objects that are on exhibition. So in the case of if you were to take a date of accession, for example, the entire background would reorganize according to date of accession. You would see the position of your object in relation to the whole other set of objects. Similarly, if you click on that little stack icon, you see all the other surrogates that exist of this object and a color analysis and an X-ray analysis, anything else that exists that documents that object. So the point is that this experience, and this is on the front screen, is one that allows you to see things that you either can't see with the naked eye or that have been excluded from vision in order to focus your experience on the object itself as a kind of atomized entity. So what does the Lightbox Gallery do? It opens up these horizons, things that you can't see. The position of an object in a larger aggregate, like where does it go fit sequentially? Where does it fit in terms of media? Where does it fit in terms of provenance stories? And this happens not only through the reorganization of the background, but also, and these are different kinds of objects, Chinese bronzes and so forth, but it also happens on the other side, where in the projection system, every time you click on a field, you see a data visualization that positions, depending on what you're looking at, material, title, location, collection, geospatial coordinates. It allows you to see the position of an object in a larger set. So the point I'm trying to make is, as an experience, this is an example. These are all the titles of 1,800 objects. Of course, you can't really see that here, but if you were there in person, you actually can see that they're all titles that are reading vertically. These are attempts to create an experience, if you like. It's a fundamentally different experience than the experience of an individual artwork. And I think, for my taste, this is one of those kinds of horizon lines. It's really an exciting one for experimenting with new models of storytelling. I'm going to close here by just talking briefly about this project that began in 2007, that is a kind of combination between an animated archive and an attempt to create a sort of form of scholarly collaboration with a kind of public-facing kind of dimension. And this project is all about sight. It's about the specificity of a sight. The sight is so specific in so many different ways that it's kind of a long story to unfold, and I'm not going to inflict it upon you. But suffice it to say that the Trentino region, which is one of the northern regions of Italy, whose boundary lines have shifted in the course of its history many times between Austria and Italy. In World War I, it was right at the center of the battle line. It is the demographic border between the German-speaking north and the Italian-speaking south. It has multiple other minorities, linguistic, demographic minorities. And like all regions that have this history of conflict, it has tons of history museums. There are little history museums everywhere because everybody has a version of history that they tell to one another, their own version. And those history museums are typically very scantily attended. They don't have an audience. They have a social importance, but they don't have an audience. So in 2007, these two superhighway tunnels at the entrance to the city of Trent, the capital of the region, had been abandoned for a series of practical reasons, and a series of other tunnels had been substituted. And they found themselves with two tunnels at the entry to the city, right across the river, that had to somehow be reutilized. And there was a public competition to try to imagine reuses of them. And the solutions went everything from a giant wine cellar to the project that my colleagues and I were successful in pitching to the authorities of the region. And our proposal was to turn the tunnels into an experimental history museum. So in a region that has so many different versions of history, to use this space, which is a space that by definition cannot harbor traditional forms of historical documentation, because paper documents, anything that's subject to humidity, you know, the kind of climate conditions that exist in a bunch of highway tunnels is by definition excluded. And this site is not only a significant site because these tunnels were built essentially eviscerating the working class neighborhood of the capital of the region of the Trentino Alto Adige, but it's also a site. They run under a cliff, which is the real identity marker of the city of Trento and of the region, on top of which is a fascist monument built to celebrate the Italian martyrs of World War I, i.e. the martyrs of the winning side of World War I, a kind of slap in the face of the German-speaking population. That's the building you see up in the right-hand corner, a site of neo-fascist rallies on a regular basis where the local pro-Italian right-wing sort of patriotic movements rally, the site of the National Alpine Museum, the site of a series of paleo-Christian churches. In short, it's a site that's very much marked with issues of contested identity to begin with. And so the project that we were able to implement in the Trento tunnels that uses these two tunnels, the idea was to create a kind of experimental history museum where all of the history museums, this whole kind of diaspora of history museums distributed in the territory of the region, would be forced to collaborate in the construction of historical exhibitions, but where they wouldn't be lending objects, but rather in a kind of distributed curatorial way, collaborating in the narration of contested events. And in this case, the launch event was an exhibition that lasted for a year on World War I, which was, of course, a decisive event for this region. And the real challenge was how to reconcile, and this is what the kind of moral of what I'm going to say here, then I'm going to conclude with, how to reconcile, in a sense, a need to bring history alive, to bring documents, the archive alive, to animate, if you like, the past, a past that's increasingly being forgotten by younger generations, but that's very much alive to older generations. And on the other hand, to exercise the highest level of scholarly rigor, you know, kind of to basically ensure the kind of seriousness and of engagement with this path, the records, with the archive that we would expect of a serious and responsible institution. So the strategy that we developed, for better or for worse, I think it was largely successful, maybe almost too successful, was this idea of dividing the narrative up into two pieces. The Black Tunnel was devoted to a kind of phantasmagoric immersive experience of the years of the war, so that the years of, you know, basically between 1914 and 1917 were narrated in the Black Tunnel in a complete atmosphere of light deprivation, where the only illumination were projections, and where we used a series of theatrical techniques as well as sound installations to basically tell the story of World War I from the bottom up, using historical materials, archival materials, organized year by year, but without a single general, without all the grand events of the war, but rather as a kind of environment that you traverse. And then you would turn around and come out into the White Tunnel and the construction of historical memory, institution by institution, year by year, would be recounted. And you see that double structure here, the years of the war, which you literally have this kind of march through time, through archives, through voices, and then the return through these stations where memory is institutionalized, through the creation of museums, repositories, and so forth. And those were curated by partners. We didn't curate those at all. We created a structure, and we let them curate them. That's the return path that you see in the upper section. So the balancing act was between this phantasmagoric kind of account, this experience, and this rather didactic, illuminated, enlightened, if you like, narrative about scholarship, memory, the construction of institutions. And this is much what these tunnels are enormous, by the way. They're 300 plus meters long each way. It's about 7,000-8,000 square meters. It's like the size of a wing of the Louvre. No budget in the world would allow you to treat them in a conventional museological way. So what did we do? We took archival materials and we turned them into spectacle. And this is the kind of thing that makes scholars, you know, shake in their boots sometimes. But so these are letters. We used very crude techniques. We projected. We basically manipulated, massaged, turned into media artifacts, and wove together an immersive experience year by year that takes you through a sea of images and voices through the years of the war, and then back through these stations to see how those memories were constructed into different kinds of institutions and narratives. You can see the years are marked with basically advertising type paper glued to the walls, and so on and so forth. There's theatrical techniques that were used, these little scrims, so that the images of these anonymous soldiers would come back like ghostly presences. The idea of the tunnel as a kind of place where you excavate ghosts from the past, where there's a kind of uncanniness, if you like, of the presence of the past, is very much part of the experience we were trying to create. And then you exited, you came to the White Tunnel, and you had a very different experience, which was much more didactic and conventional, but that created this kind of proliferation of different readings of that same set of materials. These are the little stations that show specific events. In this case, in 1987, the creation of a museum, and so on. And I'm going to show you one other example. This was the second exhibition that we did, which was an exhibition, an alphabet of the region's identity. literally an alphabet, constructed as a kind of book that you walk through down the walls. And then a third exhibition, believe it or not, on the history of Nordic ski jumping and cross-country skiing in the tunnels. That was really wonderfully fun to do, using these little passages and so forth to create. So you're gonna, you might be asking yourself, so where's the digital piece of this? This immersive cinema, this all kind of media-based, but, so the answer was in the case, and I'm just gonna quickly show this as I talk. So one of the experiments, and it completely failed, was, so the idea was, so you have this location where the years of the war, which are the central focus of the phantasmagoric experience, you don't know what you're seeing because you're so immersed in it. You hear voices, it's compelling or not, but you don't know what you're seeing. So one of the kind of perverse ideas we had was, wouldn't it be interesting if the apparatus for the show, the wall labels, were in a virtual world instead? So that when you leave the exhibition, you're at home, you can go back and visit it and see what it is that you actually experienced and pull apart the immersive experience in an analytical way. So this was the experiment to use, and the idea was that school teachers would be able to teach the exhibition before they went there and when they went there, and then after, to use the, in other words, the digital support as a way of extending the experience away from a single physical site to move you back and forth. So that idea worked wonderfully for the artistic community, the creative community. They all thought it was really cool. People came and they built stuff, they curated stuff on top of the cliff. We created a model of the second exhibition, which you're going to see in a second, which we documented as well in Second Life. This was done back in 2009. But we got very little use on the part of school teachers and the larger community. But I don't think it was a completely failed effort, because I think one of the things it does suggest is that the whole question of the kind of phenomenology of the visit, of being physically present, and how that physical presence can be extended, can be complemented, can be flanked through strategies of convergence and divergence between digital media and physical interventions. I think at least that part of the experiment was one that captured something of the truth about the challenges and the opportunities that we face as people who are excited about and interested in experimenting in this domain. I think one of the things we got right here is perhaps this sense that the digital media as an augmentation is always ultimately about the physical, about creating that kind of, designing that kind of experience that's significant. In other words, that as, you know, our augmented histories of space unfold in physical places that are always encrusted with layer upon layer of pre-existing experiences and meanings. And if we can somehow really make these experiences and meanings speak, or even better, maybe sing, you know, I think that that's the real measure that we can use to establish when we found those kinds of formulas, those sort of new and emerging genres that that really click for us and that are truly meaningful. And I don't think there's a single formula for success. I think there's only, you know, problems, opportunities, and opportunities for adventure and experimentation. Thanks.